One of the things I oftentimes do for baptismal sermons is put together the building blocks from the readings that point to the promises of baptism. I do this brick by brick, and then once they're all in place, I unveil them as part of a coherent whole. But considering today is Transfiguration Sunday, the Sunday in which we celebrate the unveiling of Jesus, that the Christ is seen in his glory on the mountain with Peter and James and John, I figure I too can preach unveiled. So, dear one, little Kirsten, know this. In your baptism, you, like Moses, become strange, yet remain in the world. You, like the transfiguration event, point to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And you, like Paul's interpretation, are freed from the power of sin, death, and the devil. Let us pray. Lord God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, may the preacher decrease that you might increase. Amen. In encountering God on Mount Sinai, Moses is changed. His faith shone. He had come face to face with the fullness of God, God's glory. And in so doing, he is transformed. Holiness is catchy, and not like some tune, you know, it sounds good, you can bounce to it, you can dance to it. No, instead, encountering God is a little like encountering a nuclear bomb. You end up irradiated. A direct experience of God puts a mark on you. He goes back down the mountain, and it's like a bee monster move. Everyone stumbling away, running as he comes back into camp. Holiness is horrifying. So he devises a way to stay in the world with his people, to lead them. He goes about his day-to-day life with a veil on, but then gives pronouncements from God unveiled, reminding his sisters and his brothers that he speaks as one who has encountered God, showing forth those radiation burns, the heaviness of his calling, showing them that he has been marked out and set apart, made strange for the sake of God's mission in the world. And we baptize, we too are set apart, yet are still fully in the world, still living out our God-given lives among people for whom God's acts in our lives have made us strange. Think about it. We're the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America, not of America. As a rule, we wear no distinctive clothing. At our best, we seek no distinctive privilege in our society. Yet as made unique through our baptism, we are marked out. We're marked out with this sign of clear water, no longer visible on our brow, but long visible in our lives. Yes, like Moses, we baptized become strange, yet remain in the world. The Transfiguration, this encounter Jesus' inner circle has with God high up there in the clouds, faced with ancient prophets, scolded for building instead of listening, there Jesus is revealed as Son of God. There, the disciples are given a foretaste of the feast to come, given a glimpse of the end of the story. the resurrection. There the glory of God is revealed. Jesus' sonship, Jesus as the first fruit of the resurrection, the precursor to the great general resurrection, which we too will be and are a part of. It's brought about there before them. And we baptize, we too are made daughters and sons of the living God. We too point to Jesus and to his resurrection. We too can trust this to be true. Finally, Paul does something tricky with Moses' veil. He reads the veil not simply as protection for the people from the horrifying holiness of God, but instead he makes a distinction between our experience of the law with and without Jesus. When we are judged by the law of Moses without Jesus, when we are judged by societal expectations without Jesus, when we are judged by our own conscience without Jesus, when we are judged by the holiness of God without Jesus, we fall short. We hide from that ever-present reality that all is not right. We veil ourselves from God and from neighbor, and there in the darkness our brokenness multiplies. Our sin expands. Sin, death, and the devil, all those powers that resist the rule of God, take over, take hold, infect us and inflict us. Like mold or cockroaches, it thrives in the dark. But in the light of Christ, those things we've allowed ourselves to be trapped by are broken up. And we are brought forth, free to be children of God. The light of the law is a fearsome thing when we ourselves are veiled. But when held by Christ, it lights our path and warms our heart. That is Paul's interpretation there, with maybe a little Luther spin added to it. So we baptized hold no special power or privilege before sin, other than that we are held fast by Christ. We too are bound and addicted to those things which would seek to destroy us, but we can trust continually that the light of Christ conquers all gloom. Through the Holy Spirit's power, we can affirm Paul's proclamation, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Little Kirsten, today we'll make you strange. For the sake of the world, you will be adopted as a child of God and point to Christ's resurrection, which you yourself will experience. And you will be made free by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen and hallelujah.